So today I'd like to discuss my work on instability of magnetic materials in the presence of so-called dynamical axion field, which is based on a collaboration with Hiroshi Oguri already a few years ago. And so this is not quite about bad metal maybe, but I hope this is of your interest. And also, so far, so this is theoretical work, and still experimental realization may be kind of speculative. I'm hopeful, but not in a very short period of time. But I'm kind of relieved because Isao just gave him experimental talk with some speculative, maybe theoretical interpretation. So maybe I'm allowed to give you some theory with speculative experimental perspective. Okay. So this work is kind of theory driven, so I apologize for starting from something very formal, but hopefully not so complicated, definitely simpler than ADS-CFT. So as you know, electrodynamics is a fundamental theory for our world, and in formal terms, it's U1 gauge theory in 3+1D. And if you just have electromagnetic field, then it can be described by Lagrangian density like this, E square minus B square. And in terms of field tensor F mu nu, the Lagrangian is just F mu nu times F mu nu, which is obviously Lorentz invariant. And also, this is gauge invariant. So magnetic field and electric field can be written in terms of vector potential and scalar potential, and they are subject to gauge transformation, but E and B are gauge invariant. So Lagrangian density is, of course, gauge invariant, and we want to require gauge invariance to our theory. But there is another possible term in Lagrangian density or action, which is gauge invariant and also Lorentz invariant, which can be written like E dot B. And in terms of F mu nu, this is anti-symmetric tensor, and with this combination is equivalent to E dot B times some coefficient. And usually we write this coefficient as alpha, which is fine structure constant over 4 pi square times some constant theta. This is some parameter. Okay. So this is allowed within gauge invariance and Lorentz invariance, but we usually don't include this term for our theory of electrodynamics because this term, as it is clear from this expression, breaks time reversal. So E field is T even, but magnetic field is T odd. So if you apply time reversal transformation, then this theta changes sign. So usually this is this breaks time reversal. And in fact, if you have this kind of term in some material, then it describes some coupling between electric field and magnetic fields, which is generally called magnetoelectric effect. So which is possible in some material, but in vacuum, usually we don't consider this. But this can be important in some applications. And I'm not going into detail, but I just gave you Lagrangian density, but to define some classical or quantum theory, we integrate this Lagrangian density over space-time, four-dimensional space-time. Then if you consider some space-time with, let's say, periodic boundary condition or something, then the total integral of this theta term is known to be quantized as theta times integer. That's why we write, we parameterize this E dot P B term as in the previous slide. So in quantum theory, we do path integral and weight is given by exponential of I times this action. So this term basically does nothing in the bulk. If you consider EV system, let's say, then this term does nothing because in path integral, E to I times alpha. It does nothing if theta is changed by 2 pi, sorry. For general theta, it does something, but if you change theta by value 2 pi, then the change of action is 2 pi times integer. So if you have e to I times 2 pi times integer, that's 1. So it does nothing for in path integral. So in the bulk, changing theta to theta plus 2 pi does nothing. Combined with this time reversal invariance, so if you apply time reversal, theta goes to minus theta. But because theta is basically equivalent to theta plus 2 pi, actually there is two possibilities for time reversal invariant system. That is theta is 0, which is obviously time reversal invariant. But there is another possibility, even under time reversal invariance, that is theta equals to pi. Because pi goes to minus pi, but minus pi is equivalent to pi. So this is another possibility allowed within time reversal. And it's already several years ago, but there is interesting proposal that the theta equals to pi actually corresponds to topological insulator in 3 plus 1 dimension. Whereas theta equals 0 corresponds to trivial insulator, so to say. And although this is not directly important for our work, this, as a background, I'd like to explain why this is the case briefly. So I gave you Lagrangian density for this theta term. So it was E dot B. But you can write in terms of vector and scalar potential, A mu. Then in terms of vector potential, you can write E dot B in this form. But this is actually a derivative of this term. So you can do partial integration. And if you have surface like this, this is 3 plus 1 dimensional system, and suppose you have a surface, then you integrate over this 3 plus 1 dimensional action to give rise to the surface term. And the surface term is just given by integral over this one. And this is actually nothing but what is called Chan-Simon action, ADA. And this is well known as an effective theory for quantum Hall system. So if you have this kind of action in the bulk, on the surface you have Chan-Simon, that is effective theory for quantum Hall effect. So if you start from theta equals to pi in the bulk, but as I said, in the bulk, pi is equivalent to minus pi or 3 pi or 5 pi and so on. And for this kind of value of theta, you have Chan-Simon term, which corresponds to quantum Hall system with quantized Hall conductance, which is equal to 1/2 plus some integer. This 1/2 comes from this pi. So surface of this system with theta term somehow has a kind of fractional quantum Hall system with Hall conductance of 1/2 times this e squared y. So this is kind of peculiar. And this is related to this famous surface Dirac fermion, which exists for topological insulator. So as you probably know, if you have 3 plus 1D topological insulator and have a surface, then you have Dirac fermion on the surface. And the number of this Dirac fermion is even, odd, or just one Dirac fermion on the surface. This is a characteristics of topological insulator. And in fact, if you start from 2 plus 1D material, like graphene or something, then you can realize Dirac fermion, but Dirac fermion always appear in pairs. So you can only realize even number of Dirac fermions on two-dimensional condensed matter system or lattice model. But if you have topological insulator, then on the surface, you can realize just single or odd number of Dirac fermion. That is one characteristic of topological insulator. And this is related to this previous observation. But yeah, as you know, these days, experimental people observe this single Dirac cone in many surfaces of topological insulators, like this. OK. So let me go back to this action, theta term, and the surface term is Chan-Simon. But actually, this theta term or Chan-Simon description is only valid if you have a gap on the surface. So if you have standard topological initiator, then you have surface Dirac mode, which is gapless. Then this theta term description actually cannot be applied because you have gapless film. But you can imagine you start from topological initiator with gapless Dirac mode, and then you gap out the surface Dirac mode. Then this system can be described by this theta term action or surface Chan-Simon action. This gapless nature of Dirac fermion on the surface is guaranteed by time reversal. So as long as you keep time reversal symmetry, then you cannot have a gap on surface Dirac mode. That is famous stability of gapless Dirac mode of at the surface, on the surface of topological initiator, but you can break time reversal by attaching ferromagnet or mixing some magnetic material or applying magnetic field, then you can gap out surface Dirac mode. And then after gap, giving that gap in field theory terminology, mass of the Dirac fermion, then you can apply this theta term description to this kind of system. So we started from gapless Dirac mode and then give a gap. So you might wonder what is interesting, but this is still interesting because in field theory or high energy physics, they start from Dirac fermion. The Lagrangian density of Dirac fermion is like this, and you can introduce mass. And let's consider two-dimensional system, two-dimensional space plus one-dimensional time. And you can consider mass time like this, which gives gap in condensed matter physics terms. Then you can compute Hall conductance for this Dirac fermion. Then I omit the detail, but if you apply standard field theory calculation, then Hall conductance is actually given by one half of B squared H times signature of mass. So if mass is positive, m is positive, then plus one half, and the mass is negative, then you have minus. And this is kind of anomalous Hall effect in condensed matter physics perspective, because in condensed matter physics, we know that if you have a gap in non-interacting fermions, then Hall conductivity should be quantized in terms of E squared H. So you usually don't have one half, but if you have this Dirac fermion, you are supposed to have one half. And this is related to the theta term surface Dirac. So for example, these days you can realize so-called gapless and massless Dirac fermion in two plus one dimensions in graphene, for example. And they already measure the Hall conductivity of this graphene, and they find this step-like structure. But this Hall conductivity is quantized in unit of plus one half, and next three half, five half, and so on, seven half. So this is signature of Dirac fermion. So this is kind of confirmation of Dirac fermion realization in graphene. But actually, okay, graph is not very big, so maybe not visible, but it says one half, three half, five half. This is characteristic of Dirac fermion. But if you watch carefully, here they measure for conductivity unit of four times E squared H, not E squared H. So if you have just single Dirac fermion, you should have Hall conductivity, which is E squared H times one half, three half, five half. But in reality, you have 4 E squared over H times one half, three half. This factor 4 appears because in graphene, actually, you have, in fact, 4 massless Dirac fermions corresponding to 2 comes from spin degree of freedom, but the other two actually comes from so-called varying degree of freedom. There are 2 Dirac cones located in 2 different points in the Brillouin. So you have 2 by 2, so 4 massless Dirac fermions. And as I said, even if you bring some other material or some other model. If you consider two-dimensional system, you can only realize Dirac elements in pair. So maybe you can kill this spin degree of freedom, but you still have even number of elements. Two and two plus one-dimensional system. But on the surface of topological equation, you can realize a single Dirac element. And that is related to this one half. So if you start from theta down action in the bulk with theta equals pi, then on the surface you can realize this one half of integer whole conductivity. This corresponds to the presence of single or odd number of Dirac elements at the surface. So there it will be. So this is how the C type of pi is related to topological equation. And so far you might say, okay, it's just a number of Dirac elements. So what's interesting about this C type of pi? Why we need to introduce this description based on Lagrangian action with C type of pi? So actually there is interesting prediction, again by these people. That is, I don't go into the detail, but starting from the theta down description of topological equator, they predict they predict new effect. That is, if you bring some electric charge close to the surface of topological equator, coated by some magnet, in order to jump out the surface Dirac mode, then you induce magnetic monopoles in some sense effectively as a mirror image of this electric charge. So in undergraduate electrodynamics, we learn about this mirror image method. If you have metal or some insulator or whatever material, and if you bring electric charge close to the surface, then you induce some mirror image charge inside the material, which is not really there, but in order to solve Maxwell equation outside the material, it's convenient to consider this mirror image. And in this case, because of this theta down, which couples electric field and magnetic field, the electric and magnetic field outside this topological insulator follows as if the electric and magnetic field outside this topological insulator looks as if there is a monopole inside topological insulator. This is the effect they can predict using this theta term. So theta term action can be convenient description of topological insulator with jumped surface direction once you apply magnetic material. Okay, so that's the introduction to the theta term in condensed quantum physics. And actually, this theta term appears first in high energy physics, particle physics, because you can write down this theta term for quantum electrodynamics or quantum chromodynamics, which is a theory for strong interaction between quarks. But the problem is that if you consider generic value of theta, as I mentioned in the introduction, this automatically breaks time reversal invariance. So once you have theta down, then you don't have time reversal. Or in high energy physics, this is known to be equivalent to a product of charge conservation and parity. Anyway, by experimental measurements, for example, neutron type electric dipole moment, we know that this theta down is almost there, or very tiny. Like less than 10 to minus 10. Okay, so you might say, okay, theta is zero from the beginning. You could say that, but in particle theory, this has been a long-standing problem because in principle, you are allowed to introduce theta. So why it's zero or almost zero, very small? That's called strong CP code. So the problem is that in principle, you can bring this data down. Nothing wrong to have this. This is consistent with gauge invariance or range invariance. So no reason not to introduce this. But in experiment, it's known that this is almost there. So this has been a long time ago. And there's one proposed solution, which is, again, to this day, not confirmed experimentally, but at least there is an idea. That is, roughly speaking, they proposed, Jane Green, back in 77, proposed that the theta effectively becomes diagonal. It can fluctuate. Then once this theta can fluctuate, then this fluctuating field automatically chooses the value, which minimizes the energy, because we are basically at ground state. So if that is the case, then dynamically solve the problem. Theta may not be zero in the beginning, but relaxes to zero, then automatically we find theta. So this may be a solution, but this brings another problem, or maybe benefit. That is, if you regard this theta as dynamical field, then there must be part of or elementary excitation corresponding to the fluctuation with theta. So, in effect, they predicted the existence of new particle for axion, which corresponds to fluctuation with theta. But this is not yet found in experiments, so this remains speculative. But on the other hand, these axions are considered to be a candidate for so-called dark matter. There are a lot of mass in the universe, which we don't know exactly what they are, but this axion may explain the existence of dark matter. And going back to condensed matter physics, so can we have fluctuating theta field, like in high energy physics, this axion field? And the answer is yes, at least in principle. Again, these people, Shuchan Zhang, Xiaoyanji, and their group, proposed that if you start from topological insulator and dope this topological insulator with magnetic impurities, such as ion, then you have magnetic moments inside the topological insulator. And this magnetic moment can fluctuate. And this fluctuation can be precisely described by this theta field, dynamical theta field, axion field, as in the proposal by Pichai and Queen in high energy. So in this way, you can realize dynamical field in condensed matter. And this may be interesting, especially because, as I said, in high energy physics, elementary particle physics, nobody has yet found axion experimentally, so this may be. And in fact, for this, fluctuation of theta is essential. So in topological insulator, theta was pi. Without fluctuation, then you can introduce fluctuation. But to realize this dynamical axion field, you can start from some trivial insulator with theta equal to zero and make theta fluctuate. That is also possible. So you don't really need topological insulator. For example, in this chromium oxide, it's known that you have magnetoelectric effect, which can be described by E dot B term, theta term, the effective action. And also in this material, this magnetic moment fluctuates, which should be described by action field, that is fluctuating theta. So there are possibilities realize dynamic action in condensed matter physics. So effective theory of magnetically doped topological insulator or chromium oxide or whatever may be written like this. So you have usual electric field and magnetic field. So here I write the fluctuating part of theta as phi. Theta, let's say, here is constant, and this phi is fluctuating. And this is coefficient of equal to theta, and this phi is fluctuating, so it acquires own kinetic energy, so to speak. And the difference from high energy physics scenario of axion is that in condensed matter physics, this phi describes fluctuation of magnetic moment, but the magnetic moment has some equilibrium value. So phi is fluctuating around some equilibrium value. So this phi acquires some mass. This is like spring constant. And in case of iron doped bismuth selenide, they estimate this mass to be rather large than 2 mm. This is the difference from kinetic. And also, this velocity is not velocity of light in condensed matter physics, but this is like spin wave velocity, or velocity of action. Then we started this work because Hiroshi Ogui is a string theorist, and they were interested in it. They are motivated by this ADS-CFT, this is not directly relevant for our work. They are motivated by this ADS-CFT correspondence, and found some instability in Maxwell theory plus Charles Simon term in high dimension, 4 plus 1 dimension, 5 dimensional space time, but they can reduce this result down to 3 plus 1 d, and they found some instability in electrodynamics in the presence of dynamic arc theory. So the natural question is, what are the consequences of this instability in condensed matter physics context, and also what is the physical mechanism of instability? And that's how we started. Yeah, we can consider this topological magnetic interface of whatever material with dynamic action field and apply electric field. And then we can consider so-called axonic polariton, which is fluctuation of axion field coupled with electromagnetic field in presence of background electric field. And so these high energy pieces originally considered axionic polariton. Condensed matter field, condensed matter physics paper, but they originally considered axionic polariton in the background magnetic field, but we consider this problem in the presence of background electric. And then high energy pieces already studied this problem in the presence of background electric field. Then they found some dispersion relation. You don't have to look into the detail of this formula, but the point is that there is a square root. And if you crank up electric field, then at some point you have some you have negative number inside this square root. That signals that's not correct. So there is plus and minus plus. And if you crank up electric field, then this second term becomes bigger than the first term. So omega square becomes negative for one solution. And that means that omega frequency acquires imaginary part. That signals instability. And they found that if electric field exceeds certain critical value of electric field, then you have instability. So that's already found by high energy physics, but it was not clear why this occurs. And also, once instability occurs, then the vacuum is unstable. So you must go to new vacuum, which is more stable. It was not clear what that means. What is the finding? So it's actually useful to consider this problem in the condensed matter context. So you have this topological magnetic insulator or whatever material with dynamic action field, and outside the system is vacuum. And you apply external field, either. And you don't apply any magnetic field, but you include magnetic field in the theory, and then solve this system. Inside this material, you have this axionic pile. And for simplicity, I impose polynomial motion at the bottom. Then you can solve Maxwell equation and so on, including this dynamical axion. And let's say this is the axis, and there is a boundary surface of this material at some value z. And let's assume uniform solution in x and y direction. Then energy density within this material can be obtained like this. So it's a function of external electric field and magnetic field inside the material and also outside. So So it's a function of B, and usually B is zero because I didn't apply any magnetic field. But in principle, you can have magnetic field. So I regard this magnetic field as a variable, and then this is simple function B. So you can find the value of B, which minimizes this energy density inside this material. And usually, minimum is given by D equals zero. That's a usual situation. You don't have any magnetic field because you didn't apply. But if you crank up the value of external electric field E zero, then the situation changes. And it's easier to see in terms of plot. So if you have C type of zero to begin with, but have fluctuating action field, then if E0 is 90% of critical value, then, okay, it's not clear, but this is the energy density as a function of magnetic field, so it has single minimum at B equals 0. So you have B equals 0 as a ground. But if your external field exceeds the critical value by, let's say, 30%, then energy density as a function of magnetic field looks like this. So double wave potential, so you have spontaneous symmetry breaking. So the ground state is given by either this value of B or this value of B. So you didn't apply magnetic field in the beginning, but you kind of spontaneously generate magnetic field if in the presence of strong electric field. So this is an instability, physically speaking. So I run out of time, so going to wrap up, but this means that if you apply electric field and crank up the electric field, then the electric field inside the material increases, of course, but at this transition, above the transition, the electric field is completely screened, whereas initially there is magnetic field because I didn't apply it, but it appears. So this is a kind of wave function at the strong level. So hopefully we can realize this phenomenon in some material, but using at least this bismuth selenide doped by iron, it looks very difficult because this material probably has the axial mass of 2 milliarton volt, and if you plug in this number to this formula, then critical field is like 10 to 8 volts per meter. So what we can do is that if you can suppress this axial mass, somehow then you can suppress this critical field. And that can be probably done by, for example, tuning the system close to magnetic function. Then this magnetic fluctuation becomes softer and softer, that corresponds to smaller mass. So in principle, you can suppress the critical field like this. So, so let me summarize. So, yeah, we started from Maxwell theory, plus dynamical action field. Then this system has some instability and a strong electric field. And the resulting stable state corresponds to complete screening of electric field above some critical value, which is accompanied by spontaneous generation of magnetic field. So that is a spontaneous symmetry. And in principle, it can be.